to thank all of you for coming. I really, really do appreciate it. And see some familiar faces there. I'm Linda, and I'm going to be talking about my sabbatical report, Promoting Equity, Lived Experiences of Home Health Nurses. I'm a sociology instructor, and I'll talk more about why my interest in this topic and how we can help make it relevant for you. Since we have a small group, I think we have about 14 or 15 total, and unbeknownst to the Zoomers out there, your name is being entered into a box. I may pull your name out to see if you can answer a few trivia questions along the way that I've incorporated into the presentation. And then we'll figure out how to get your little prize to you afterwards. We could have people pulled out here too. Okay, so we already just took care of that. So I'd have to start with a little bit of audience participation. Maybe we'll start with the folks in the room. Tell us your name, the area you're from, and what was your interest in coming into this topic today? And then we'll go to the Zoom folks. Yeah, we'll start. All right, Aaron.
My name is Aaron Pankratz. I'm from Todd Martinez's division, Social Science, and Linda Vang, of course, division.
Yes.
So my grandparents had home health nurses before they passed away. Mom probably could have used one. Passed away this summer, but didn't ever get. Yeah, so she never had
I'm so
that.
sorry for your loss, Aaron.
I wanted to hear what Linda's always exciting to listen to. So I wanted to hear what Linda had to say. So, yeah.
Thank you so much, Aaron. Sorry for your loss. Yeah.
My name's Sage. I'm a counselor over at the DSPS office. So, I've worked with students with a lot of medical challenges. I kind of felt it was relevant. Years ago, going out to California in the high schools, there was a couple students who were like home health and things like that. So that was kind of interesting to see how we could help before really all this online access. So when I saw that, I thought, oh, okay, I just want to check it out.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Sage, for coming. And this is Randy, my helper, student ambassador. Thank you for being here.
No problem.
All right. Who would like to start? I'll start with, I see Todd first. I don't, may help me with folks.
Did you?
Oh, do you want me to?
Oh, do I have this ready?
Okay, this is ready. How am I gonna? We'll start with Todd and then we'll go around. How will I call them?
Up to you. However you want to do it.
Todd, would you like to start?
Answering your previous question or answering the trivia
Yeah,
question?
like your where your interest in what you teach and why you're interested in this
Oh, I'm
stuff.
from the social sciences. I teach psychology. My interest is sort of similar to Aaron's. Both of my parents have passed away, but we were looking at home health care for both of them, and it was kind of confusing. But also, I do recall seeing in the news articles about home health care providers trying to either change their status or get higher pay and benefits or something like that. So that's sort of those two things together kind of brought me to your presentation.
Right. Thank you so much, Todd. Should I just call on people? Because let's see, Sandy, would you like to share? Sandy? Sandy, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. I'm sorry, having little technology issues.
Oh, that's yes. Not to worry, not to worry.
Yeah.
A little bit of where you're from, your interest in the topic.
You know what? Basically, I've got some family members that are moving into the health field, and they're really trying to kind of solidify areas of interest. And also, we work with a lot of nursing students, So it'll be a great idea to broaden their perspective of the scope of nursing in general. And, you know, home health does come up, but it's kind of not like one of the top choices on their radar. So I'd like to kind of get a little more acquainted with the information that you have to share so I can kind of utilize it when I'm seeing students as a counselor.
Thank you, Sandy. And there could be kind of a reason for that with home health not being maybe on the radar, right? Because sometimes we don't think about it. And a lot of nurses might go into hospital work first or clinic work first, right? Before they kind of go out into that field, because then you're very independent. But absolutely, it's a growing field. So it's important to know about. I'm just going to call on people here. Is Bobby there? Bobby?
Yes, hi.
Hi.
Hi. So I'm Bobby, and I'm an instructor with DSPNS. And basically, I've had handfuls of students with family members involved with home healthcare situations. And I'm just kind of curious about your experience and the topic in general.
Okay, thank you so much, Bobby. Carol?
Yeah, I think that's me. Hi.
Thank you, Carol.
Hi, sorry. I was that's having okay. background noise.
So, no worries.
Yeah. So you asked why we chose this session?
Yes.
I don't know anything about home health care nursing. I have a former student who went into nursing, and she became a home health care nurse, and she really loves it. But I don't know really what she does, much about her experiences. So that's why I'm here today.
Good for you wanting to know about that. Thank you. Natalie?
Hi, everyone. I'm a counselor at Fresno City College. I'm Natalie. I do see a lot of students who are in the health or health and science fields. And so it's interesting to just kind of know what home care nurses do and the experiences so we can share that with our future potential students who want to go into nursing. So thank you.
Absolutely. That was one of the things that underscored my presentation. It's like, let's present all the opportunities for our students. Their possibilities are endless. So thank you, counselors. Lily? Sunny?
Hello, yeah, I'm here. I'm an EOPS counselor here at Fresno City College. I am part of the STEM pathway here for EOPS. And the major of nursing is a very popular one here at Fresno City College. So just trying to learn a new angle, get some additional information that I could pass on to the students to help.
Thank you so much, Sunny. Thank you so much. Is Peter here? How about, is it Mai? Mai?
Yes. Here. Good afternoon, Linda and everybody. The reason I'm interested in this workshop is because Linda's a great speaker, and I'm always interested in all the topics that Linda talk about. And I'm also interested in this workshop because I have a few family members who gets in-home supportive services. So I think this will be a very relevant and a good topic for me to know. And also I work with the nursing and allied health students with research. So I would just like to know more about this topic in general. Thanks, Linda.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I have, is it Zanzu? Am I saying that correctly? X-U-A-N-Z-H-U?
Yes. Good afternoon. This is Xuan Zhu Song. You can address me Susan. Maybe it's easier.
Suna?
Yeah, I'm here. And then I want to tell that the attractive things for this topic is about the home healthcare. It's not only for myself, but also for my family members. Maybe I can still use this to serve my students. So that's what I think I should learn something from here. That's why
awesome.
I'm here. Thank you.
Thank you. What do you teach?
I'm teaching economics, microeconomics and microeconomics.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you. Tiffany?
Hi, I'm a DSPS counselor, and very similar to a lot of people in the group, I have family members who utilize home health and just kind of wanted a little bit more information.
All right, thank you so much. We've got Erin. Tamara, I've seen you up there.
good afternoon. My name is Tamara Epperson. I do teach accounting classes. And the reason I chose this particular class is because recently I just had my father. He's now going to be having home health. So I'm interested in getting information as his power of attorney because I need to know what to do. This is all very new to me. So I hope to also use this knowledge to somehow touch students, but it's really personal for me while I'm in this class.
Well, yeah, Tamara, thanks for sharing. And, you know, at some point, if, you know, you'd like to get together with me too, because I was a social worker in home health, and that was something I had to help people navigate, right? And so I'd be happy to help you with that. So what department?
Yes.
You're in accounting. You. Okay. How about Yaneth? Saying that correctly? Yaneth? Victor? Okay. We got caught, right? Suk Chan?
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Suk Chan Sandhu. I'm from nursing faculty here at Fresno City College. And I'm here to hear about your experiences, and hopefully I can learn about some opportunities that I can share with my students.
Thank you so much. And I'd be happy to come into your class too. Part of the sabbatical was if we could present in classes. So I just throw that out there for you. Okay. Thank you. Is Rebecca there? We have a few more people and then we'll get started.
Rebecca, so you can call Rebecca and Nelson.
Rebecca Nelson. Oh, Rebecca Nelson.
Hi. Yeah, I just saw Rebecca, another Rebecca in here, I think. So thank you. I'm with the business division, business and technology. And I also personally, have family member using home health currently for the last 3 years. And I just want to say that our personal nurse that comes out, or her personal nurse that comes out, is just off the chart awesome, and has taken really good care of her. And but I know that there's more than just this person. What happens when he's no longer available, or anyway, I want to enlarge my knowledge too with the whole home health issue.
Rebecca, thank you so much for. You said off the chart, awesome. That's the emotional connection that I found that nurses make. And those were the observations and my interest in working with nurses, because I could see it, I could feel it, right? Their stories, right? Mm-hmm. That connection to the human experience. And
so I kind of saw that in your expression, so sharing that with us.
Thank you. Is Rebecca Slayton there?
I'm here. Can you hear me, Linda?
Yes, thank you.
I have several reasons as to why I was interested in this. First of all, I think that sabbatical projects are usually pretty darn interesting. So the topic interested me. Also, my mom received home health care in the remaining days of her life. Fortunately, she was a World War II veteran. So all the costs were like 100% taken care of. But I have to say that my experiences with the home health care that she got were so positive. They were caring and wonderful. And when she went into hospice care the last few days of her life, they were wonderful too. With that said, not everybody has the same type of coverage that World War II veterans have. And so another concern that I have, and I get also information from NPR like Todd does, is that with the baby boomers, you know, getting older and having to take care of their elderly loved ones, it's very stressful on people who have to take care of elderly loved ones, especially those that are sick, making home health care particularly important. So I'm interested in the social and economic issues that may affect some people's ability to get the home health care that they need.
Yeah, and I'm right there with you. And if we could get all of us at the end, I talk about, you know, public policy, right?
Yeah.
To write our legislators, and we'll talk more about that. But thank you so much. We'll go.
But I would, I did want to say that I think that nurses are just an incredibly valuable and such an important profession. And she just got such wonderful care. I was very appreciative.
She through the VA system.
Yeah, so the way the VA works is the most benefits are the ones who are the oldest veterans. And since she was World War II, she got 100% covered everything.
That's wonderful. I'm sorry for your loss, and thank her for the service she gave to our country, right, during her years, and how that passed on to you. Thank you for sharing. Is it Shalom? Bernard.
Dr.
Bernard Navarro, you better answer that call.
Well, I appreciate you doing this presentation today. And I'm hoping that, you know, I can take something from it for my sociology classes. Yeah. You know, we teach a section on the live course. And I think an area I am a little deficient in is like towards the end of that life course. And we focus so much on the early socialization, but there's that socialization process towards the end as well. And I'm just really interested in what you have to say. I have a lot of respect for you, and I love our conversation. So I'm just really happy that I'm able to participate today.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. I'm going to show a small window into the research because I had so much information, but we'll talk about that. Thank you, Bernard. Matthew there?
Hi, can you guys hear me?
Matthew. Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Okay, no problem. I'm a respiratory therapist that teaches here in Fresno City, and I also do home care visits on the side. So I just wanted to kind of see more of the nursing side and just contribute where I can.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, Matthew. Thank you so much for coming. Respiratory therapy, more of that technology going into the home, right? The increased need for that. COVID, oxygen, all those things. Very, very important what you do. Thank you so much. Jeffrey, how about... Devion?
Hey, how's it going? Good afternoon. I'm a general counselor here at Fresno City, and I joined just to learn more information. You know, knowledge is powerful, so getting to know, like, the resources for students, even for my parents, and just in general.
Thank you so very much for coming. Much appreciated, that open mind to more learning. We have just a few more. The people I called earlier that didn't respond, we'll just go ahead and move on. But I do have a few more. I see Victor Yang. Victor, did you want to say anything? Okay. Lorena?
Are you trying to talk, Betty?
He's muted. Victor, did you want to unmute? Okay, Lorena. Got Damian. How about Laura?
Hi, my name is Laura. I teach math. In addition to having nursing students in my statistics classes, I'm also here because I have a family member who's currently in need of home health care.
Excellent. Okay. Awesome.
Hi, Linda.
Linda.
It's Lori.
Lori,
I just wanted to say hi. I joined just because you were doing the presentation mostly. But also, I think that whatever we can learn to help our students, just kind of knowing more about what's available in the community for their family members. So if they're struggling because they're having to care for somebody that's in their family, that they can utilize the service and they can focus on school. Or also, like Sandy was saying, when they're interested in going into careers so that they're aware of all of the options that they have. But again, I'm happy to hear what you learned on your sabbatical.
Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate that very much. Kind words. Alejandra?
Hi, I'm Alejandra. I teach communication courses. So similar to others, I'm interested in being able to share some of this information with my future students who are interested in nursing, because I have heard a lot of interest in that field. And I also have family members that recently graduated as well. So I'm happy to share this information with them as well.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And Michelle, is she there?
Linda, can you hear me?
Is that Victor?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. You're on. Victor.
I have my mic mute, so I'm my apology for that. Yeah, I have my mom at home, so there's a nurse that coming to see visiting her. So I'm curious about that as well as for myself as a counselor.
Okay, great. Thank you. And I apologize. I know there were some people that didn't answer. So maybe this last minute or so, did anybody want to introduce themselves and say why they're here? And then we'll move on with the presentation.
Hey, Linda, this is Yaneth.
Okay.
Yes, so this is Yaneth Ramirez. I work
Danny for Ramirez.
Yes, Humanities Department.
Okay.
And I teach Spanish, and the reason I'm here is because I want to learn more about your nursing program.
Okay. I was going to tell you that I'm a sociology instructor that studied nurses, but we do have some, we'll kind of get you interested in this topic and see where we go. I wrote down some notes here, and I'm already seeing some qualitative research possibilities, right? We have people here for personal reasons. Family members, families that experienced home health care, and then also for our students to get them interested in nursing and this particular field. So I'm so grateful that you're all here today. Thank you so much. Anyone else want to say anything?
Thank you.
All right, let's get started then. The objectives, I want to explain my research process and the project and the findings. And throughout, I'll kind of highlight some of the lessons I've learned from the sabbatical journey, what to do and what not to do. Don't do too much, which is what I ended up doing. And then the pedagogical implications. I do have a handout, so I'll have to work with Susie to get emails, right? I have copies for these folks. Yeah, I could get copies to you. And the goal here is, as I talk about equity and what nurses do, and obviously teachers aren't nurses, but home health nurses have one aspect of educating as their role as educators, to kind of think about ways in which we do some of these things as counselors, as teachers, right, staff members, in working with our students with regard to equity. And then I have some trivia questions, just a few. I think it's three or four. And I want to say I'm a day late and a dollar short because I put that in. Last year, I remember they're having hard time having people come. And it was like, try to think of different ways to create it. So they do kind of fit in with the presentation, sort of. But I thought it would kind of help with a little bit of engagement. So I'm going to pick something out here and call on somebody. These are very low stakes. Questions, because we do have a first question coming up, and this goes to Bobby. Bobby got an answer. If not, I'll go on to another name. Is Bobby there? Three.
Yes, yes, I'm here.
All right, Sorry. Bobby. Guess what, Bobby? Thank you for paying attention in class, Bobby. All right. The first trivia question goes to Bobby. What is the name of this building? And I'm going to give you some choices. The old Fresno Water Tower, the old administration building at Fresno City College, the Cathedral of Learning, or the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Bobby, your answer is...
I say the Cathedral of Learning.
Absolutely correct. All right. And I will make sure we get emails right for folks. You're going to get a little trivia prize.
All right.
I got my little packets here just to show I did bring them. Okay. It is legit. And I put this up here for a couple reasons. Okay. I'll go to the next slide. Just some of my background for a little bit of credibility. Okay. I'm from Youngstown, Ohio. I went to small college in Ohio, Mount Union, but I got my master's in sociology and my master's in social work at the University of Pittsburgh. And this is where we had classes. And I just kind of, those of you that are interested in buildings and architects, this doesn't have like a steeple or ending point, right? So people say, why was it called a cathedral? They'll build into the philosophy of the schools, like, you know, have faith and wisdom and learning, but always remember to continue to learn, right? And so there are these different levels, right? I don't know if they expect to go any further. But for me, as an educator, and I think for all of us, right, we're learners, and chances are we are lifelong learners. And one of the best ways that I have learned throughout my career as a social worker in all these various home health, healthcare experiences and settings is the stories, right, that people have told me. And it's from those stories, right, that I believe I, as an educator, have learned the best. And so oftentimes when I teach, I like to tell stories to illustrate, right, concepts, ideas, human connection. So I've had a lot of experience in home health, probably over 30 some years. And I went back at 50 years old to get a doctorate degree. Fresno State had the program with UC Davis. And I had the amazing opportunity to use home health as my program. And I sampled, interviewed nurses for my dissertation on how they worked in advanced care planning. So one of the things I learned from that is that nurses love to talk. So if you're interested in doing interviews and qualitative research, they have amazing stories. And, you know, just as part of the sabbatical process, a few things came up that were interesting. I didn't share this with the last class I did, but I'm going to share it with you folks. I had a nurse that I was hoping to interview for a background. She was retired, so she didn't fit into my sample criteria. But she was unfortunately in early March hit by a car walking her dog in Clovis. And they never really did find out what happened. It's an unsolved case. But the world works in mysterious ways. And so we were all shocked by this. I dedicated my sabbatical to her. Barbara Rote is her name, if anybody happens to know her. And I went to the service. And like, lo and behold, right, I saw all my home health nurses that I worked with, my friends. Right. This was unanticipated. And many of them were so very interested in being interviewed for the project. I already had my 10 nurses, but I did tell them I would get in touch with them. They were so interested in telling their stories. It's just interesting to me that I had that experience while I was doing this. And the other thing that happened was unanticipated. My 14-year-old dog, in January, I was diagnosed with a terminal lung tumor. And she was my companion, right? And we knew she would decline. She overcame seizures. She overcame arthritis. She was up walking around. She had an anal gland removed for surgery. And then the tumor hit. And I thought, isn't it interesting, this unanticipated time that I had with her, because I had the privilege of having the sabbatical accepted. So from my heart, right, the research is very important to me. And it's such an honor to be able to be here presenting this. And I hope that I've, you know, honored the nurses of their stories. And I know that this has benefited me in ways that I didn't think would be possible or anticipated. So I just want to let you know that's part of my kind of perspective. So I've worked with nurses over 30 years. There's something interesting to me about nurses. Someone in the someone on the Zoom mentioned, right, awesomeness of nurses. I think I wrote that down. Off the chart awesome. another in the other class, someone said, you don't think about nurses or home health until you need one. Something about their skills, their presence, their interpersonal communication that I was able to witness, be witness to so vividly, right? When we would do home health visits, sometimes together in our interactions with patients. So I don't know, they're an interesting population to study. They're wonderful human beings, the ones I've had experiences with. You know, of course, we have problems with all kinds of folks, right? But I wanted to say, and someone else mentioned this as well, health nurses are essential to the healthcare of a nation. That is like so well documented. If we have nursing shortages, right? City College is going to graduate a lot of nurses, so hopefully not. We would delay surgeries, right? Research shows that we don't have enough nurses. It impacts patient safety, quality of care. They're essential. So I had to make sure positionality is a term we use in qualitative research, right? I had to be aware because I was very close to these nurses. I used a convenience sample. They were people I knew. And some of the cases they talked about, I knew some of those cases, right? Others I didn't. What was my view? What position do I take? I had to be careful not to influence findings and knowledge. And I have to tell you at times, because of the emotionality of these experiences, these nurses providing the compassionate care to the most vulnerable populations in Fresno, right? Our poverty rate, many of you know this, about 22%, maybe higher. State of California, it's only 13%. That's still high. We're double. We have health literacy issues. And when I talk about home, it's going to be the perception of the home from the patient, because it's not always that residential, comfortable home that we think about. So I had to be careful. I had to almost shut off tears, try not to be too emotional, because I wanted to hear the voices of the nurses, right? What were their stories? And I didn't want to put my interpretation on their voices. So this is a constant reflection back and forth in qualitative research. So this was the purpose of my study with the sabbatical, as Aaron may know, because he just finished one. How can I tie this into the mission of the college? How can I make it relevant, right? So I went with the idea of nurses displaying equity in everyday interactions with patients, right? And then ultimately, we see home health care as a system, right? Albeit it has problems, right? Some aren't as good as the VA system, as Becky Slayton mentioned, right? But that system can promote socially just care, it does, and has the potential to do more. And I'm very passionate about that. Because if you think about, right, equity and accessibility, nurses are going to the patient's home. The access is there. Our patients, right, when I ask nurses, what's the number one or two problems you see that patients have to overcome? Transportation. What's easy for us is a million times more difficult for our patients, right? We may say, hop on the bus, get an Uber, have a relative take you. Almost sometimes impossible. Getting medication delivered, somebody picking it up. Again, those are some of the challenges, right, that we still continue to face. By way of definition, social justice is a view that everyone deserves quality health care, and equity promotes, again, access for everyone to achieve their optimal health, right? Health care is a right that all of us should have. So talk a little bit about home health care, various models. As we were mentioning, there is the health care as a benefit of Medicare, right, for age disabled people. Home health care can be provided for Medi-Cal patients, right, the lower income form of insurance. It is a benefit often under most insurances, but again, it depends. So it's there though, it's available. I know Fresno Community Hospital will oftentimes do charity cases in the event that a patient needs help. And the VA home-based primary care, this one's interesting. I think Dr. Slayton mentioned that was what her mother may have had. They follow patients from the time they see them until they die. So these, I had two nurses that worked under the VA primary care, and that is an incredible system to be able to do that, because these are often patients, again, that can't get to clinics or hospitals. They have a hard time. These nurses are actually so critical to these patients' needs. Medicare has a certain time periods, but you know, they could be out there for a few months, 2 months, several years. It just depends on what the need is. It's prescribed by your physician or a hospital physician upon discharge. If you happen to go into a hospital, you can always ask for home health care at any point of access in the healthcare system. You'll get professional services, right? And we already have a respiratory therapist that does some home health care. Nursing, occupational therapists, physical therapists, speech therapists, medical social workers, home health aides. And the patient usually has to have difficulty leaving home. I'm going to put home in quotes. From what my research saw, we had some interesting situations with home. Okay, so we said it's going to expand, right? And what is the reason? Increased in aging population, right? This, all of you know, right? We're no longer the pyramid with the demographic with few people at the top. I think we're more like the rectangle or the inverse pyramid. And I think Japan has the oldest population. I was reading about Japan, and I even saw where they're closing down one of their elementary schools there because they will never no longer have children at that school. So this is real. And aging, the baby boomers taking care of their parents, and then the baby boomers entering, right, the healthcare system. Shorter hospital stays, chronic and terminal illnesses are now they're chronic versus acute, an emphasis on palliative care, keeping people comfortable, and then perhaps moving them into hospice care if that's the case. More technology in the home. We already mentioned respiratory therapy, oxygen therapy. The nurses during COVID, which I'm not going to be able to talk about too much today given the time limit, but they were saying they were out there, right? COVID hit, they're there. They don't have time to go home and prepare themselves for a week or two. They were doing a lot of teaching on oxygen because of the consequences of COVID, right? Home dialysis, right? Home care is thought to be more cost effective, and people want to remain in the home. So these are important things to consider with regard to home health care, well documented. So this is my attempt at an infographic, and I wanted to show what nurses would do. I picked nurses because that's my, you know, sample, right? They may do wound care. They may do IV therapy. They may go out for safety evals if people are falling, right? And then get physical therapy involved. They may give certain kinds of injections. I already said IVs, instruct on medications, right? Instill catheters, ostomy care. So there's a variety of things that nurses will do. And again, why did I pick nurses? Well, nurses often tend to be case managers, right? They tend to be the ones that we say open the case, admit the patient to home health. They might request then other services, ask the doctor to send out, you know, a physical therapist, right? Develop a plan of treatment. They're often the first to encounter the patient in what is perceived as their home. And one of my colleagues, Melinda Vinicor, as I was sharing some of this with her, said, it's so interesting to think about these nurses because they could choose a more comfortable form of nursing, right? This is challenging to be out there in the field, as we call it. They chose to do this. These nurses that I have worked with and interviewed love their jobs. So we'll talk more about that. Giving away the trivia question. So I'm quoting myself here. Nurses are the heart of delivering this care to diverse communities. So this question is going to go to, let's see. Is Jeffrey there? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Jeffrey?
Yes.
All right. You get the next trivia question.
Okay.
You ready?
Sure.
What president referred to nurses as the beating heart of our medical system? Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, or Woodrow Wilson?
Is it Roosevelt?
And you are close. Another guess there, Jeffrey. I know what you might have said, Roosevelt.
Wilson?
Another guess there, Jeffrey. You're very close.
Obama.
Obama. Thank you.
Wow, I'm striking out. Clinton said that then, I guess.
Oh, no, it was Barack Obama. Oh, you okay. Got it right. Right. You got it right. Yes, you did.
Yes.
By process of elimination. I'm thinking you said Roosevelt because of the New Deal, right? Social Security after the Depression. Yes. Not sure why you said Wilson, but Barack Obama, and make that connection, 2010, I think he spoke to the American Nurses Association and was talking about, right, Obamacare, right, the affordable health care plan. So I want to thank him, and I might write him a letter, because I struggled with that equity at an interpersonal level. And when he said that the beating heart of our medical system, I went, that's it. They then are the foundation, right? You have to have the heart. You have to have that interpersonal connections, right? That's what the system builds upon. And Obama, thank you, helped me see that connection between day-to-day interactions and what we can build upon, right, as a medical system. Thank you, Jeffrey. I'll find you on campus somewhere to get you your little gift. So this is my specific study then, right? Provision of services by nursing professionals. I say non-institutional settings, and I say that because there you go. The diversity of settings that these nurses saw from my research. Residential homes. Having a home, but seeing the patient outside of the home for various reasons. Down the street from their home. Public places. In shelters, at bus stops, on the streets, in the city and rural areas. You know, we would go to Tranquility, San Joaquin, Firebaugh. We'd go down to Orange Cove, sometimes Tulare County, Riverdale, Lemoore. The outreach here in the Central Valley is wide. I would love on a Saturday morning, I retired from home healthcare, to get up, have a few patients ready to go, get my coffee, and just drive. And I knew that when I was going into that home, whether I helped them with a handy ride referral or an advanced directive or communication with their nurse, whatever it might be, that you felt like you were providing a service. And so it's tremendously rewarding for me and an honor to be able to do that. So I found this quote from Tilda Shelloff. She wrote a book. She's a Canadian nurse. She's amazing. You can look her up. She wrote a book on home health care in Canada. She said a hospital nurse discovers a home health. I think it was like No Place Like Home, right? And I think this picture is kind of tell the story. I'm not ever going to underestimate the important work nurses do in the hospital. Absolutely, right? Absolutely. But you see, she said, in the hospital, we see their illness. But in home health, we see their lives. And so you could just see, right, the nurse with the person experiencing houselessness, living in that area. You see the whole of the person, the holistic part of the individual, right? Just think about, I think, the importance of being mindful, perhaps sometimes of our students, maybe, or their families, right? So moving on. Use the grounded theory, qualitative method. Grounded theory, you look at all the data, you try to find patterns. Are nurses saying the same words? Are they saying the same thing? Are they giving the same meanings to those themes? I use semi-structured interviews. I had too many questions. I had so many questions and so much data. I analyzed most of it. Some of it I just did in some preliminary quotes, right? I had a convenience sample of 10 nurses. Those were nurses I knew. I transcribed, analyzed my data. I followed the district's instructional review process for informed consent. For credibility and reliability, I did something called members checking, meaning I checked with the nurses if they would say something to make sure. I was doing automatic transcription, but also I reviewed the data to make sure I had the meaning of what they said. I mean, that I had the correct accuracy of what they said. I collected some demographics. I had a lot of questions. Today I focus on patient interaction. So lots of years of experiencing nursing. Home health was a little bit less. And this kind of goes to my point that nurses may have worked in other areas and then came to home health. I had a beautiful ethnic representation of nurses. So I was very grateful for that. I didn't get into too much of the cultural dimension of this, but there is that aspect to look at as well. And these were some of the settings they previously worked in before going to home health. Okay, so these were the themes that emerged from my data. I'm going to talk about flexibility and caring relationships because I don't have too much time to get into all of them. I do have a handout. Oh, you can pass that out already, I think.
Yeah.
So what I'm handing out, Zoomers, is just these words here, right? Just have these words. And I just left a little space there. And I said, you know, as I go through these findings, and you could do this in the setting where you're at, I'd like you to consider how various themes around equity might apply to your students, because this is equity at that interactional level. This is one way that the literature can see and observe equity in action. And do you have similar examples, right, with your students, right? Try to be specific. If we have time, we'll share. I'm not so sure we'll have too much time, but I want you to think about this. So I just say flexibility, right? We're flexible. It's an equity mindset. I love looking through the equity lens. I love it. I know we use the word a lot, but it has helped me so much because if I see equity, then I see flexibility. Well, then I see, you know, I can be, you know, not judgmental, right? Work on being not judgmental. So these are things that I hope, you know, we all kind of take a look at. So I'm going to present it just with some quotes. We won't have time to go over all of them, but when I rep these, we will call these representative quotes, right? In my paper, I have more of the stories around these quotes, but just to point out, right? Nurses navigate unfamiliar and unknown territory, and to be, you know, make the comment as well that if a situation appears to be unsafe, right, likely they're not going to go there or, you know, we're going to check it out a little bit more, right, because you don't put yourself in danger, right, in these situations. For the agencies I've worked with, that's an important point. But they want to give the best care, regardless of the circumstances. So my patient was at a shelter and they have rules. She had to leave for the day. So was she homebound? I would meet her outside of the shelter, sometimes at the bus stop, and I would do the Una boot therapy, which is, you know, for circulation, putting a bandage around her legs and wrap her legs where I saw her. Nurses could be a little bit, I call legitimizing deviancy, because they're supposed to document home status, and they do it. They say she needed the care. We're going to track her. She needed the care. You see, the system sometimes, the bureaucracy of it, gets in the way of providing equitable services.
And I think that we need to understand that. Be flexible if we can. How about this one, right? You got everything you need in the hospital, glucometer sticks, strips, medication, right? You're in la-la land. And then you go to home health. And maybe they have the glucometer sticks, but they don't have the meter to put them in, or vice versa, right? They need the hospital bed, they're coming home, and guess what? It's not there. So, and they may be changing a PICC line in a hot trailer during the summer without air conditioning, one nurse changed Foley catheters in a target parking lot at the end of a van, right? In a van. This quote came actually from a student I had at City College who happened to be one of the nurses I interviewed for the project. He said, "We're out collecting blood. I'm getting oriented. I'm looking, where's the computer labels to track all this?" "Oh, we don't have them," the mentor said, right? "Find a piece of tape, write down the information," right? So you become, he said, you become kind of like a MacGyver. I'll get back to MacGyver later on in this presentation, right? I saw one man, he didn't want me to go in the house because it was cluttered, it was trashy, right? So he wanted me to be outside. So I did his dressing changes and wound care, right? In 100, 110 degrees heat in the summer. This one was interesting because the patient was houseless. And because of where his wound was located on his lower back bottom, she could not change anything out on grass or by a bush. She couldn't do that. So they went to the nearby fast food restaurant. And they used the male restroom. He was a man. They locked the stall. She set up her sterile field on the sink. She had two bags. She put on her gloves, and she put the dirty bags in a bag, then doubled up and threw it in the trash. She said, "I'm going to make it happen for him." Everybody was happy, and it worked out. Flexibility. Thinking on their feet, getting the job done. One patient was seen in an abandoned mortuary on the west side of town. The nurse was double checking, right? "Do I have the right address? Is this where I'm supposed to go?" And the patient thought it was great that she had that place to stay for a short time, a few weeks. Someone kicked her out, probably found out she was there, right? But the nurse was doing dressing changes, and she said, "The situation wasn't easy for me because she had recalled her nephew's funeral there several years ago. And so she kind of had to take a step back, but make it work for the patient, and had to set her feelings aside to care for her." So here's the MacGyver question. This is going to go to, let's see, Sage. Sage happens to be here live, face to face. How is MacGyver significant here? MacGyver was a home health nurse extraordinaire. It's another term for flexibility. He played a secret agent on TV, known for solving problems with unconventional methods. MacGyver is a nursing technique to provide care. Is it A, B, C, or D?
C.
C! Do you know MacGyver?
I've heard of it.
Apparently he used to use, what was it? Duct tape and chewing gum? I haven't heard about that story in home health, but it's probably out there. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Why don't you read that for us, Aaron?
Okay, caring relationship. As a nurse, we have the opportunity to heal the heart, mind, body, soul and body of our patients, their families, and ourselves. They may forget your name, but they'll never forget how you made them feel. Yeah,
Angelou. And I have a trivia question. This is a quote that I want to look how it's phrased, right? Because I read this and read this and read this as a nurse. Okay. So who is Maya Angelou? Angelou? A nurse? A poet, scholar, storyteller?
sociology instructor, our well-known Hollywood actress. This goes to Lorena. Is Lorena there? Five, four, three, two, one. Lorena? How about Devion? I know he's there. You talked to me earlier.
B.
B, congratulations, right? I saw that, you know, she's a poet, scholar, storyteller, right? A profound. Lost her, right, several years ago, right? A few years ago. A nurse. She had, as I researched this, held nurses in very high esteem. Apparently her mother was a nurse. Now, I don't know what her relationship was with her mother, but she held them in high esteem. And she was asked, I think 2007, to attend the SAGE summit that met at the University of Minnesota Nursing School. And I think they awarded her some type of honorary degree. And that's where she talked about nurses and the rainbow in the cloud. Story that she has about, right, be a rainbow in someone's cloud. If you're not familiar with that, you can look it up. And the idea is that, right, a smile, be that smile to someone who may not be having, right, a particularly good day. Thank you, Vivian. So what is that caring relationship like? So think about this, respect and non-judgment. Cognitive empathy, building bonds and emotions, celebrating success. These were the themes that emerged, right, from the nurses' stories and quotes. So look at this one here. Are there any of those that you can think about that you might utilize as a teacher, as a counselor? Do you walk into that classroom, right, with an open mind? When that student comes in and sits down and talks about their what they want to do, their career choices, right? Do you connect to, you know, their circumstances? Do we demonstrate that respect, right? Do we think about what their space is like? Someone asked me, you have to know when coolness has occurred. What is that? And that was a quote from a nurse who worked with a pimp on and off for several years. I believe I'd seen him at one point as well. And it was a difficult situation. I think at various times we had adult protective services out there. You know, I don't want to paint a picture that this is all rosy, right? It's challenging, obviously. And she said, you have to know when this coolness has occurred. And so sometimes we say to each other, right, we're cool, right? And what was that like? What was that how do I deconstruct that interaction? You know, and it was like, I'm going into the home, kind of, you know, going to where the patient is coming from. What is his expectations? What is his needs, right? I'm listening, actively listening to his needs, right? At the same time, I'm seeing, you know, a couple of girls going in and out of the apartment, right? Trying to kind of sort this all through. And then the patient starts joking a little bit, you know, light appropriate joking. And she kind of joking back. And so as you begin to see that happen, right, coolness is starting to be cool, right? You may be doing what you're doing. If I see any, you know, something that needs to be reported, right, the nurse is going to do that. And they had with that situation, sometimes he was belligerent at times, depending on the situation, right? But you're going in there and doing that care. So this becomes, you know, again, very emotional, your mind, your heart, right? Your legal requirements, your ethical requirements, get involved in all of those, right? And I know that sometimes even with patients, the patients with students, we face some situations like that. I don't want to be the kind of nurses, I'm better than you kind of nurse, right? No, I wouldn't do that, right? This is their home. I'm going to respect their wishes. And so you'll see some of this come in here. you know, we see a lot of sharing electricity cords between apartment houses, buildings, things like that. And right, you know, that happens. The nurse's job to, is this safe? I'm not going to judge that. People need to make ends meet. This nurse said she'd go to the home, and the patient said, let's go a few doors down. And what's her name? Loretta said, I'm not going to question her, but okay, I'll do the dressing change there. And a few visits later, right, the patient revealed, everyone's doing meth in my home, so we're going to meet here. Right. And Loretta said, fine, I'm not going to judge that. I'm going to do what I need to do. She was obviously trying to protect the nurse. She took care of her need. So cognitive empathy. Do we connect with the positive, negative feelings of others? Sometimes takes action. Right. This was interesting. These nurses tried very hard. Right. Well, trying to respect the knowledge of the patient. I think about teaching, right? I want to respect, what does that student know? What does that student bring into the classroom? There were some very interesting parallel practices, right? What works for the patient? What works for the students, right? I'm sure you can teach me about diabetes just as much as I can teach about diabetes to you. And it becomes like a team approach, a level playing field, right? Where patients don't feel threatened or feel there's a power hierarchy. This nurse, I try harder. She said, some patients don't get it no matter what. I go, what do? I try harder. She kept saying, first you try to find ways to do what they need, taking their meds. How do I see it? I try to understand their point of view. Then I go back and nothing's changed, right? And then I give alternatives, right? You try to get to the bottom of it. Right? I try harder. I just keep trying harder. And perhaps sometimes we do that as well. I like the language this nurse used. She goes, I have to spin it. You got to spin the language. What do you mean by that, right? A good teacher has to figure it out. You got to spin it in different ways. This had to do with trying to get the patient understand when did you have a bowel movement? And that's what the patient didn't know, what bowel movement was. And so she's going through different words, right? And finally got to the word that the patient knew, right? I'm not going to say it, right? She goes, sometimes they just don't know. Sometimes it could be the language. Sometimes they don't know, right? You worked hard to get maybe, in this case, it wasn't an interpreter. It was just that the patient didn't know what she was getting at. You've just got to keep spinning it around. And around. So this was an interesting quote because this nurse said, and I'm going to wrap this up in a little bit, ask you to participate. Sometimes they don't want me to come in there and tell me, you know, I'm going to tell you to do this. They want to do what they've always been doing, but you know, you're there to help them. And this nurse said, patient was giving him a hard time. And he said, hey, bro, I could just leave, right? But you might not like me, right? That might not happen. But at the end of this, you're going to love me, okay? Because we're going to beat this together. And sometimes I think maybe students don't want to meet those deadlines. So they may not like me, but are they learning something at the end of this process? I'm going to open it up to you to see just maybe 2-3 minutes, because I do have a video for you and some pictures I want to show. Does any of this resonate? Cognitive empathy, respect, non-judgment, flexibility. We also have building bonds and emotional connections. Many of you, when you shared your personal experiences, right, you said those nurses build bonds with us. These nurses in my study built bonds even after they left. They get texts from patients, please come by, I've made some muffins. Other nurses will say, I've developed friendships, right? A lot of emotionality, sometimes sadness when their patients would disappear. I don't know about you sometimes, but I do feel sad when I'm working with a student and then the student disappears. Anything about these? Anybody want to make a comment? We have time for one comment. Is there anything in the chat? Okay.
What's saying that?
Aaron.
Almost all this applies to teaching. It's amazing because you need to have these same attitudes as an instructor in the classroom, or I would imagine as a counselor too, as you're trying to help somebody out, you have to take the student where they're at. You have to advocate for them. I mean, you're their greatest ally when they're on campus. You're their greatest advocate when they're in our classroom to try and help them succeed. And the goal is kind of the same, not as much health-wise, but in helping them have the goal is to get them to a better job, a better life, better career, trade, whatever, where they're going to have a higher income, support themselves, family. So it's all about making themselves more successful in terms of being able to care for themselves. So. Yeah,
absolutely. I was really amazed by that. I was going through it. You know, I almost didn't expect it, but that was at Equity Lens, right?
Yeah.
And I really did not expect this to happen. And I kept seeing it more and more and more as I was going through the data, more information here about emotional bonds and connections. One nurse said, I saw a lot of dying in the hospital, and I thought there'd be no emotion in home health. And she said, it's even worse right there, because now I know the real them.
Yeah, Matthew.
Yes, Matthew. Matthew, yes.
Oh, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. No, I just wanted to, say the kind of build off of everything too is I feel like for everyone who is interested in just learning more about the field and the impact you can make, I think a lot of our respiratory students, when they go to school, they just graduate. And I really feel like their main focus is on getting a job inside of a hospital. And they don't get to hear a lot of the stories like we're hearing right now about how much of an impact you can make on these patients' lives. And so I feel like at least, in our field, when respiratory, I know that it's definitely an underserved patient population, just because it's kind of, it's kind of just an area where I don't feel like the students who graduate really have a focus on wanting to work there right out of school. I think it's something that they have to hear these stories about, or hear my stories that I tell them in class, just to even bring it on their radar. A lot of their clinical experience as well is in hospital settings or different settings like that. We just recently got a DME rotation started. And so they're going to start going to a home care company and seeing that side of our profession as well. But yeah, we make a big impact. I was just telling the students the other day that I set up a newer respiratory device for a lady who's on oxygen all the time. And she literally started crying right in front of me because she said she could breathe for the first time. And, that was a very powerful, situation to be in and to be there with her and say, you can have a better quality of life and we can help you. So I just wanted to share that. And I appreciate all of the stories and experiences that you guys are sharing. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Matthew, for that experience, because you're in the field, right? In that moment, right? It's just kind of like frozen in time when she cried and said that to you in her home, that she could do that. And to your point, right? You made a difference for her, right? And you celebrated that success. That was one of the themes, right? Nurses want to see that. They want to see that wound heal. Celebrate it, right? It's like, I find gratitude and I'm so happy to see the wound heal. I'm so happy to see the patient, right? Breathe. Those were themes that came out in this research. So I only have a few more. This was very touching, right? This family would always say to the nurse when she'd come, welcome home. Right? And at that point, Gina, the nurse, became emotional. I want to show you the short video that we did, and I have a celebrating success. That was the other one. We want to celebrate the success of our students, to celebrate the success of our patients. So that was a conclusion. I want to say, based on my research, that they practiced equity. They're the beating heart, and they are that, here it is. They are that part of that system that can address healthcare issues at a public and policy level, because this is people's lives. And I think that's the part that, we can become
impact, right? Healthcare legislation. So I'll stop there with that. You know, we have a responsibility to be aware of injustices. We need to think about them emotionally, intelligently, and critically reflect on them. And just some quick pictures. I'm going to show you the video. I went down to the Fresno State Mobile Health Clinic. I got in touch with a nurse. Dr. Moya is a family practice physician. His quote was, "There's no place other I want to be. This is where the healthcare begins." And so that was a wonderful experience I got invited to. A little bit about keeping their dogs safe at Pavarillo, a nurse. During the pandemic, I didn't have time to talk about this, but you know, we're putting it on, we're taking it off, we're putting it on, we're taking it off all day long. Hand sanitizer that was made by a wine company when they stopped distribution of wine. So they made hand sanitizer. Their bag might look like this, and your desk might look like this, your own health nurse. Okay, a thank you note from a patient to a nurse. I keep this with me to make me realize I'm making a difference maybe in some people's lives. And the video. Okay. Here you go. Pay attention. If somebody's still there, let's go for it. Michelle.
You don't have pepper there, so I'm not sure if you want to give it to her.
All right, Michelle. Susan.
I'm here.
All right. What two animals did you see in the video?
No, I don't know.
That's correct. You might have seen the little we call them the street family chihuahua all around the streets of Fresno, but they do belong to somebody. And at the end there were some donkeys, but we'll give it to you. That's the end of my presentation. I don't think we have time for questions, so the other group is here But thank you so much. And if you want to get a hold of me, Linda Bang in sociology, I'm very grateful that you came to my presentation. Someone has their hand up. Is there a question in the chat?